Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to the very, very last game of the tournament, TATA Steel 2021. And before, I'm gonna show you this Armageddon game, because this was completely dramatic round. The last round, the last two rounds were dramatic, because Anish Giri was half points ahead, and he had the chance in the 12th round to win against Alireza Firuzia. He actually had a winning position with 4 pawns for the knight on the two sides of the board. They also had the rook, however, Anish Giri just miscalculated something and he drew that game. So huge drama, because in the last round he would have to just draw against David Anton to just win the tournament without any, you know, playoffs. So huge drama. And then we had the three players with the half points behind Anish Giri. So it was Alireza Firuzia who just drew that game. It was Jorden van Foreest who won the game. And then it was Fabiano Caruana. And in the 13th round, in the last round, Fabiano Caruana couldn't win, so he drew against Arjan Tari, and Jorden van Foreest won against Nils Grandelius and just equalized with Anish Giri, who drew. Anish Giri couldn't win against David Anton, so we had two best players. Also, we had some drama, because Alireza Firuzia had the game against Radosław Wojtaszek, and the referee told him just to move to another table. That was also very, very dramatic. Probably a bit unpolite, maybe unprofessional. I'm not the referee, so I cannot say that, but this was also very disappointing in this tournament. However, even if Alireza would win, he couldn't qualify to the playoffs. So the score just didn't matter much. However, still, you know, that was just another drama during that tournament. Also, we had the two games ended with the draw. I mean, Anish Giri could win the first blitz against Jorden van Foreest, but he didn't find the winning continuation, and it was the draw. So Armageddon decided who wins this tournament. Anish Giri with the white pieces have 5 minutes, and Jorden van Foreest with the black pieces has 4 minutes, and draw is enough to win the game. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board. We had the d4, d5, and now bishop f4, London system. If you play for the win, why not to play the London system? Of course, black have to be extremely precise, but also have the ways to block the position, if you know, of course, knows what you are doing. We have knight f6, we have e3, we have c5, we have knight f3, we have knight c6, and now knight b2d2. We have e6, we have c3, so very, very typical structure with the bishop already out of this triangle, with the knight set up on the position, protecting each other, also very, very solid by Anish Giri. We have bishop d6, now challenging the bishops, bishop g3, and of course black doesn't want to exchange, because that means that white would have the open h-file. And here the main line is the castle, so this is pretty well-known theory, but we have h6. This is the sideline. We have bishop b5 now, so pinning the knight. And here again, one game in the database where castle is still possible ended in the draw. However, we have bishop e7, so another move with this bishop. It seems like Jorden van Foreest is pretty nervous and he makes some random moves. Maybe preparation, maybe not. This is Armageddon. He has 4 minutes. He had to move, pretty fast. We have knight e5 immediately attacking this knight, which is pinned, and now queen b6, now attacking the bishop. And now we have a4 defending, and now finally castle. We have also castle by Anish Giri. We have a6 kicking the bishop, bishop c6, b takes on c6, and now d takes on c5. So Anish Giri wants to strike in the on the queen side with tempo, bishop c5. We have b4, very similar to the Meran system in the Slav defense, bishop e7. And now a5, attacking the queen. And now queen b7, and it looks like the queen doesn't have many good squares, because the knight is still keeping an eye on d7. This London bishop is extremely dangerous, controlling all the dark squares. So, you know, black cannot just, you know, forget about that. It's extremely tricky position. We have knight d3, so now the knight want to come to c5, knight d7, defending, but now knight b3. So now two knights are focusing on the c5. And here it seems like rook e8 would be the best option, making some space for the black pieces, because let's say this bishop is you know, locked over there. So if black want to make some space for the bishop, definitely maybe the knight moves here, but then it would not cover the c5. So it's a very, very tricky position, but maybe the bishop could find the way over there or something. I'm not really sure, but look at the black pieces, all of them are stuck over there and doesn't have the space to move. In this position, however, we have queen b5. So this is a little bit random move, because now we have knight d4 attacking. So queen b7 going back, and now rook b1. So preparing to some, you know, pushing the pawns, opening the b file. And here we have knight f6. Again, rook e8 probably the best here, but we have knight f6. And now the problem is that knight c5 is coming without any problems, and this knight now is completely annoying. So Jorden van Foreest decided to give up the pair of bishops, but you know, we cannot call it the pair of bishops, they are completely locked over there. Bishop c5, b takes on c5, with the discover attack on the queen, but at least the queen can move somewhere. So we have queen d7, but now rook b6 going after the pawn, and there is no way to actually save that pawn. We have knight e4 at least going after the knight, or maybe after this pawn, which makes more sense, because at least black would have the first piece which has a little bit of freedom. Anish Giri doesn't care about this pawn, so we have rook c6, knight c3 with the attack on the queen, and now of course queen c2, taking under control e2. So the knight, for example, cannot jump there and, you know, deliver some forks or something. We have knight b5, this is the plan. So now we want to remove the knight on the d4, but now after rook b6, you know, Anish Giri asking, are you sure you're gonna do that, because then I'm gonna have, you know, protected passed pawn, and that's gonna be, you know, completely winning position, especially this bishop is still, you know, supporting the advance of this pawn. But now we have a knight a3 with the attack on the queen. So, of course, this is with tempo, and the knight gonna come to c4. And indeed, that's the best what black can do here. What white should play is just simply queen c3, and after knight c4, just continue the game with the c6. With the attack on the queen, queen would have to be moved, rook f to b1, and then white have a completely dominating position, especially that all of these squares are controlled by this bishop. This bishop is a beast here. So completely winning position for white. However, Anish Giri started to think, and he think over 30 seconds, so he just burned his time, and he just played c6, just giving up this pawn, because now of course Jorden just exchanged the queens, so we have knight c2, c takes on d7, and now knight d4. So now if white decide to create the queen, then of course black gonna have the tempo here with the check, and then with the exchanging the bishop here, so exchanging all of the pieces, and only then get to this end game. And this end game of course is winning for black with one extra pawn. That would be very, very difficult for white to win, because white has to win. So that was not possible. This is why we have e takes on d4 by Anish Giri, and now bishop d7. So the only asset, very strong asset, just vanished. So Anish Giri lost that pawn. We have rook c1 getting to the open file, bishop b5 now locking the bishop on this position. position. Bishop d6 with tempo going after the rook, rook f2 c8, and now bishop c5 also saying, okay, I'm not gonna exchange the rooks. Of course we have rook c7, and now you know, preparing to double the rooks, and then the rook is gonna be very strong here. So the rook goes to e1. We have rook a2 c8 as planned, and now f4. So Anish Giri has to do something, has to for example attack, a minority attack, attack on the e6 and try to find the weakness. For example, on e6, it looks like a pretty good weakness. We have h5, we have king f2, we have king h7, and now h3. So preparing g4. We have king g6, g4 as planned, h takes on g4, h takes on g4, and now rook c6. So, Jorden van Foreest saying simply, I want to exchange this rook. Anish Giri doesn't want to rook b7, but Jorden van Foreest insists, and there is not much choice. We have rook from the 8th rank to c7, rook b8, rook c8, rook b7, and then rook goes back. So we would have a threefold repetition, and Jorden van Foreest would actually win. This is why we have rook c7, it's forced, rook c7, and now rook e8. And it looks like pretty dangerous position for the king, maybe even some mating net, especially this bishop is controlling f8. But it's very difficult, you know, to deliver the checkmate with only the rook. But Anish tries to deliver at least something. So first we have bishop d7, and now rook g5 with check, king h7, and now bishop f8. So it's a very, very tricky move. Now we have a g6, so the dark squares are completely weak. So rook goes back to e8, and we can already imagine that this is gonna be some kind of checkmate. Very, very fancy. We have f6 now attacking the rook. Rook goes back to e3 following the plan, but now of course the king has the way to escape. King g8, we have bishop c5 locking the position, rook b7 now getting the rook to the open file, but now Anish says, okay, you're not gonna pass. We have bishop b5, so Jorden van Foreest also saying, I'm gonna lock the position here, I'm very happy with the draw, and I still have one extra pawn. And Anish says, not anymore, rook e6, we have king f7, and now rook e1. We have rook e7, trying to exchange the rooks. Anish, of course, doesn't want to, so rook c1. And now rook e4, going after the f4 pawn. So king f3 defending, and now bishop e2 attacking the king. So king g3, rook e3, and now king f2 attacking both of the pieces. So of course rook just goes to the e4, still defending the bishop. We have rook c7 with the check, we have king e8, and now g5. And here, believe me or not, with the seconds on the clock, this is the 56th move, and after the move 60, the player is gonna get some extra time, because of course this would be very easy to flag the opponent. So that was the plan of Anish Giri, but he doesn't really know, you know, which move is that. So he doesn't really know it's you know, the move 58 or maybe 60 is coming. So he knows that he has to do, it's just the feeling and experience that he has to make a couple of more moves. And here Jorden van Foreest, believe me or not, but he played the losing move. In this position, he delivers a check and wins the pawn, but of course the rook was defending the bishop. So here Anish Giri gets that gift, and he has completely winning position. The problem is seconds on the clock, so it's he going to be on time. Of course we have f takes on g5. We have rook a7 going after that pawn, and once this pawn is taken, then of course this pawn is going to win the game, and it's nothing Jorden van Foreest can do about that. Very, very dramatic position. However, exactly in this position Anish Giri got flagged, and yeah, he lost the game. So the winner Jorden van Foreest is the winner of the tournament. What a dramatic end. So after Jorden van Foreest make a blunder by losing the game, we can say he actually won by the blunder. That was so unexpected blunder that Anish Giri, I don't know, that was, he didn't have enough time, and that's what happened. And yeah, if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss other games on my channel, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.